It's Thursday, July 18th, and you're listening to the Geek News Central Podcast, sponsored by GoDaddy.com. And actually, the date is July 21st. Geek News Central is a program of the Tech Podcast Network. Everyone, welcome to the show. And it helps if I update my show notes. Got a lot to cover tonight. Got a lot of exciting stuff for you. Lots of tech, of course. You know what comes next. Strap in. Here it comes.
All right, people, I need a go, no-go for the Geek News Central Podcast. Digital archive recorders.
We're go fly.
Microphone.
We're go fly.
Video feed.
Go.
Web browser.
Go.
RSS data stream aggregator.
Go fly.
Interflux Toddism suppressor.
All right, I'm confused.
Host readiness check.
Welcome to the show. Welcome to the show.
The Geek News Central Podcast is a proud member of the Tech Podcast Network. If it's tech, it's here. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are ready to go. Cue Todd in...
5.
Button, who's got the button?
4.
There is no cause for alarm.
3.
Everybody hold on to something.
2.
Just press the button.
1.
Showtime.
Aloha and welcome to the Geek News Central Podcast, coming to you as live as it can be from the beautiful state of Hawaii via the Geek News Central Studio overlooking Greater Honolulu. Hey, everyone, welcome to the show. My name is Todd Cochran, and I want to encourage you to get over to geeknewscentral.com and check out all the great content over there. Of course, check out all of our family of shows. We've got a whole lineup for you. Everything from the Gadget Professor, Robot Underpants, a Saturday morning Tech and the Chrome show. Lots of coverage at Geek News Central, so definitely get over there and check out all the shows. And while you're over there, definitely get subscribed to them. Subscribing is the best way to stay abreast of what's going on. And you can do that by coming right over to GNC. And basically, there's a column right there on the right-hand side of the page that allows you to get subscribed. And that way, you'll never miss a single episode. Well, I tell you what, we've got lots to talk to you guys about tonight. And lots of tech. And it's going to be a good show, and I hope you guys will hang out for the whole proceedings. We want to welcome our listeners from 185 countries worldwide. And, of course, and when you're checking out the show and checking out the other shows on the website, sign up for the newsletter. The newsletter contains everything that I'm going to talk about during the show. That gets punched out immediately following the podcast, and it contains all the links to all the content that I'm going to be covering. But I tell you, a little bit adding some components can be tough, and I'm adding some new components to the show tonight in an attempt to up the game a little bit and not make some of the same mistakes I made here about, on the last show when it comes to the sponsor stuff. So we're going to kind of add some extra additional elements tonight. Hopefully that all goes off without a hitch. It would help if I would get to the point where we can get someone else to switch for me, but just going to relax and have fun here. Hey, we're streaming live right now at techpodcast.com/live and also at live.geeknewscentral.com. Of course, this show is streamed every Monday and Thursday night. And we get started about 2 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, which is pretty late for most of you. But we're definitely get going about 11 p.m. Pacific. So if you get bored and you're looking for something to do just before you go to bed, tune in to the website. And we're always up Monday and Thursday doing the show. And, of course, we got the Saturday morning tech show that starts at 9 a.m. Pacific every Saturday that I'm here in Honolulu. So let's talk just a little bit about what's been happening. Shoko's scheduled to come home on Monday. Just got off the phone with her. And I'll fill you guys a little bit more on the situation when she gets home. But at this point, that she's done what she can do, and her dad is still on life support. But other than that, we're going to get her home here and get her back stateside. If you've got comments on today's show, geeknews@gmail.com, geeknews@gmail.com. Of course, you can call our voicemail hotline at 619-342-7365. Hey, I want to talk to you just a little bit about our sponsor, GoDaddy.com. And GoDaddy's got some great products for you over at their website. And I've got a special for you this month. You can get a 3 months of economy web hosting for just $1.99 per month. And all you got to do is go over to GoDaddy.com and pick up the product. And when you get to the checkout counter, you pick the promo code Geek77. Geek77 will get you right in there. If you want to use other GoDaddy promo codes, all you got to do is come over to geeknesscentral.com. There's a link on the website that says GoDaddy promo codes, and it'll load. It'll basically show you all our promo codes. Geek5, Todd20, Todd, ComSale, ComSale2, Geek Central, Aloha, Geek SSL12. Lots of great offers for you, and we've got an additional special one running through the end of the month where you can get a .co domain for $13.99 by using code GEEK1399. Again, the hosting plan, the hosting deal, which I showed you just a second ago, which is available for $1.99 a month, which gets you 3 months of economy hosting, is only through the end of the month. So we've got just a few days left on that, so we hope that you'll pick that up over at GoDaddy.com. We want to thank GoDaddy for being a longtime sponsor here at Geek News Central. And, of course, definitely check it out when you get a chance. So let me go ahead here and see if I can bring the right menu up. And this is becoming like a dance for me. And we'll see how this works when I make the additional switch. Well, anyway, so Shoka's on the way home. And so I'm looking forward to getting her back here in Honolulu. And at this time, we're also making the switch up. We're going to be hiring some more writers at geeknewscentral.com. So if you've ever considered doing writing for a tech blog, this is a paid position. It is a position that you get out of it what you put into it. So definitely send me an email here at geeknews at geeknews@gmail.com. We're hiring a couple of writers. Want to bring you on board. Send me links to commentary and content that you have written up before, or if you're just getting started, we can do that as well. We've got kind of a new guy type of program as well. So if you've never wrote on a blog before, we can get you started that. But anyway, looking for folks that run or write on tech, science, information going on in the space, basically all the type of content you see day in and day out at Geek News Central, consider being a writer over here. Also, if you're getting ready to go to a trade show or a conference, be our eyes on the ground. So if you've already got your pass to go to the show, don't worry. Just drop us a line and let us know that you're going and that you're willing to write articles during the show. And just basically tell me a little bit about the conference you're going to, as long as it's tech or social media related. We'll get you on board and we'll make you one of our writers. Basically, you just be a stringer for us at the event. So be our eyes and ears. Some of you have been following some of the stuff I've been saying on Google Plus and on Twitter. But as you know, a week and a half, or actually 2 weeks ago, I went for a full-blown physical. And while everything turned out good, I did talk to my doctor about some issues I've been having while sleeping. Well, essentially what my wife has been complaining about while I'm sleeping. And obviously it's keeping her awake at night. And frankly, got to the point where she was being a little bit scared by what was going on. So she feels that I had some sleep apnea going on. So I noticed that I've been waking up more tired, and it definitely was, I put on some weight, so that probably hasn't helped the situation. So I went over to did a sleep study on Tuesday night. Didn't sleep real well, but they said they got what they needed. And after reading up about sleep apnea, fellas, if you getting any complaints from your loved one whatsoever, please tell your doctor, because sleep apnea left untreated can lead to very bad things happening to you at a very young age. And so, you know, all of us men have enough trouble getting to a ripe age, and nursing homes are full of women. They're not full of guys. So, listen to your significant other or your loved one, and get in and tell your doctor what's going on. She had me in under a week, and I'll have the results in 10 days. I'm pretty sure what the answer is going to be. And so that, you know, there's a couple things you can always do for yourself. One, you know, lose that 25 or 30 pounds you need to lose, or if it's more, lose whatever weight you need to lose. Number two is to make sure that you, if you get diagnosed with sleep apnea, that you follow up with the device that they're going to prescribe for you to use. And from everything I've been hearing, and after kind of talking about this a little bit online and Google Plus and some other places, it's changed a lot of people's life. And hopefully it will, it'll be something that will help me if this is what the diagnosis is. But you know, I've shared with you guys throughout the years, different things have been going on, and I wanted to talk to you just a little bit about that. But, you know, so I'm on the road to losing weight. The first goal is 25 pounds, and we're going to take time to get there. We're not going to go on any crash diet, do anything stupid, but it's important to get the weight off for a number of reasons. And so that's the plan. So I'll keep you advised on how the tape measure and the old scale marks are going as we work our way down, I hope. So, hey, I want to introduce a new sponsor to the show. Actually, let's take care of a current sponsor. And then we'll talk about the new sponsor. And I'm really excited to talk about this new sponsor, as you can tell. But I want to make sure we cover the original sponsor. And I don't think I have one of the documents open I'm supposed to happen to open up. So I'll get that set up here right now. You know, this show is basically, you know, my lifeblood. And it's what takes care of my family and how I feed my family. And the sponsors, without them and without your support of the sponsors, things would be a lot more difficult around here for sure. So I want to talk just a minute about a GoToMeeting, Citrix GoToMeeting specifically. And you guys know that I have used GoToMeeting for a long time. And, you know, in business today, people are really on the go. You know, whether they're home or working from working while traveling, it's really almost impossible to get a number of people in the same room for a meeting. And that's why I've been using, and I recommend GoToMeeting by Citrix. Everyone can meet online no matter where they are. GoToMeeting allows you really to collaborate on documents in real time. It's like being in the same room. Anyone can present, and you don't even have to be trained on this. It's just that easy to use. And again, you can get started in just minutes. Attendees can join with just a click, and you can hold as many online meetings as you want for as long as you need for a low monthly rate. Free phone conferencing and voice over IP is included. And here's the best part. And as we've been displaying on the screen, for those of you watching the video, you can try GoToMeeting free for 30 days. Try GoToMeeting free for 30 days by going over to GoToMeeting.com, click on the Try It Free button, and enter the promo code podcast. That's GoToMeeting.com, click the Try It Free button, and enter the promo code podcast to get that free 30-day trial. So I want to thank GoToMeeting for being a longtime sponsor here at GNC. Okay. Now, what we'll do in future shows is we'll spread the sponsors out across the show. But what I wanted to talk tonight about is a new sponsor coming on board. And we're excited to have that sponsor on board and see if I can make the right switch here. We've got Carbonite. Carbonite has come on board as a new sponsor for the podcast. And they're stepping up in a big way. And they've made a great deal for us. And if you're not a Carbonite user already, I have a hard drive. Matter of fact, I was going to bring it down. It's back there on a shelf that a number of years ago, right when you remember when my dad died, I had a hard drive that basically went south several months after he passed away. And on that drive was about 2 years worth of pictures that were nowhere else. And for some reason in my backup scheme at the time, those pictures did not get backed up. So I had to send that hard drive off and spend big, big money to get those pictures recovered. It was worth it to me to pay the fee. But no matter what you do, at some point, you're going to have a hard drive go south, or you're going to have a backup that hasn't been done correctly. And really, Carbonite Online Backup protects your pictures and your other computer files by automatically backing them up wherever you're online. Now, here's the cool part. I loaded Carbonite for the first time 2 days ago, and it immediately went through and registered everything that it was going to need to back up. And I've got a pretty big stack of stuff, and it told me how long it was going to take to do the initial backup, and it started sending off to the cloud. And it's still not done because I've got a huge amount of data that's going to go up into the Carbonite backup system. So when that crash happens, Carbonite makes it easier to get your backed up files with just a few clicks of the button. And here's the amazing part. This is a statistic that's just going to blow you away. Carbonite has helped restore over 7 billion computer files. Now, I think I had 123,000 myself, so you can see how they get to 7 billion pretty quickly. So unlimited backups for your PC or your Mac, anytime, anywhere. I love that saying. Access is only $59 a year. That's less than $5 a month. Pay up front one time. Use the promo code TPN over at Carbonite, and guess what? They're going to give you 2 months free. So you're going to get 14 months for the price of a 12-year subscription. $59 is what it costs. Try the trial. If you've never used it before, this is a serious backup application. So start your free 15-day trial at Carbonite.com. No credit cards required. That's the best part. You don't even have to put no information in whatsoever. Just an email address. Use the offer code TPN. Again, you get 2 months free if you decide to buy the product. That's Carbonite.com, and the offer code for free 2 months is TPN. You want to welcome and thank Carbonite for being a new sponsor here. They're going to be here for a while. So you guys are going to hear me talk about this more and more. Let me go ahead and make sure I get through the full stack of stuff here. Don't forget, we'll have Saturday Morning Tech Show, and then we're going to go right into the Chrome Show, and of course, the Gadget Professor posted his new episode up tonight. That's at the top of the webpage, and definitely check out the full line of streaming shows over at techpodcast.tv, and all the guys over there are streaming. That's, we have members at Tech Podcast that are already up and running. Again, if you got comments tonight on the show, geeknews@gmail.com, and if you have comments about the show, call the voicemail hotline at 619-342-7365. So enough yak. I'm already long. And we got a lot of tech to get into today. And let me see if I can bring this up. Yes, I can. And we'll flip this off. And hopefully I did everything right there. Juggling too many things at one time. Let's talk about Apple. Boy, oh boy. And of course, that's the thing we got to talk about first and foremost. And Apple's right out of the gate with 1 million downloads, 1 million installs of Lion on the first day. And, you know, so what I did immediately was, you know, when I knew Apple was available, I mean, the Lion was available, I basically went in and did my $29 purchase. And I did it in the morning. I had to be away from the office for 2 or 3 hours. And basically, I hit start and walked away from it, and by the time I got back, it said, you know, go ahead and click here, and I clicked, and it was done. I mean, it was upgraded. For me, it looked, you know, like it was instantaneous because I had been, you know, out of the house, so I didn't have to hang around for the download. I was astounded how easy they made it to upload, or how easy they made it to update to Lion. I mean, they really have their act together in a big, big way in this install. So I played with one machine for one day and made sure everything seemed to work, all the tools I normally use and some of the weird software I have. It only called out a couple of things, and it wasn't even really important stuff, and it put it in a folder that basically says, hey, this is incompatible. And so I loaded it on, I did that on the first machine, my newest machine. And then I went ahead and went over to the App Store and pressed buy again. And guess what? I didn't have to pay a second time. It just installed it. So $29, it looked like it's going to update all my machines here at the house. That's remarkable. And that is, I think, the best part about this whole upgrade, $29. And it's all tied to your user account. And once I install a machine, if my wife logs into it, she'll still have her upgrade. It'll all be upgraded at once. Really cool. It really, really was. Now, there are some good articles talking about, and if you haven't done the upgrade yet, they do have, the folks over at GigaOM has a good article on a OS 10 10.7 Lion installation checklist. And basically, first of all, they make sure your Mac can handle the upgrade. They suggest upgrading the RAM up to at least 4 gigs. And, you know, some of you have not bought RAM from Apple recently, the difference in price, when I bought my first, when this machine back here that I have, this Intel Core 2 i5, non-gloss screen, when I went from 2 to 8 gigs of RAM in that machine just a couple of years ago, that was like $600. Now, when I bought the newest machine a couple of weeks ago, it was i7 quad core, and I went from 2 to 8 gigs of RAM. The upgrade was like a couple $100. It was very much more inexpensive. It may not even been that much. It may have been 100 and something. So upgrading the RAM in your Mac right now is, it's a great time. The price is good. Just go into the Apple Store and have them do it for you. You can run some utilities. You can run backup. You know, that's something important to do. I didn't do it. I just went for it. So, but I've got everything backed up on, what do they call that? It's a time capsule. So I had a backup there. And make plans for apps that won't run on Lion. And so you want to check your apps and locate a fast network connection for downloading the install, because it's 3.6 gigs of a download. And that's what the folks over at GigaOhm, they've got some more tips in here. I have this linked in the show notes for you to check out on doing the upgrade. So it's a great upgrade. Actually, I didn't show you that, did I? Well, that was dumb. Well, let me show you the other article I found over at GigaOhm. They've got a quick review, and I'm sure many of you have already done your homework here and have went through. But they talk about OS X Lion review, the shape of things to come. It's talking about the boot process. And by default, it opens all of your applications to their state at power down. So really, this is kind of cool. There's like an autosave. It just autosaves where you are at. I generally shut everything down before I shut down. Some folks aren't happy with the Windows management systems giving way to what's called Mission Control, which offers a little more visual clutter. I'm not bothered by it so much, but a couple of the applications I don't use Mail, but there's been some upgrades to Mail. But the Finder redesign, they could have really, and I agree with the folks over at GigaOhm, they could have come up with something. Finder, to me, has always been a poor man's Windows Explorer. It's horrible. You know, there's maybe I just don't understand how to do it, but there's my file in Finder. I want to click on it and grab it and pull it somewhere, and it'll launch a stupid application that it's tied to, and then you have to press another button to try to figure out where its location is. It just drives me crazy, and maybe it's just operator error, but Finder could have been improved. But the $29, you can't beat the $29 price point. So love to hear you guys' feedback on what you guys have done with Lion, what you think of the upgrade so far. Drop me an email here, geeknews@gmail.com, voicemail hotline 619-342-7365. And of course, Apple introduced the MacBook Air 13-inch they basically upgraded the entire MacBook Air line. And I actually heard that the lowest of the line MacBook Air outperforms the top of the line MacBook Pro from last year. I found that to be pretty remarkable if it was actually that powerful. So the folks over at iFixit did a teardown of the MacBook Air 13-inch. Gotta love these guys for going ahead and tearing into this thing. But basically took the screws off the bottom, pulled the cover off, looked at the, looks like a RAM module. No, it's probably SSD module. And they can upgrade, that means you can upgrade the SSD. Some people have been complaining about the speed of the SSD. So we'll see what happens when someone comes out with some third-party stuff. And then the battery's held down by four Torx screws, so you'd have to pull those out. But once the batteries are out, it gives you access to the Wi-Fi and Bluetooth board. And they were pretty easy to remove. And then they break down the mini PCI wireless card chip. And then they go even deeper into removing the fan and that module. But they go a lot deeper into this thing. They break this bad boy down to parade rest. And it doesn't take them... You know, it doesn't look like too bad of a teardown. And looks like they were pretty careful, so they probably were able to put this bad boy back together after they were done. Obviously, they probably voided their warranty. But you got to love a site that will take a $1,000 machine and break it down to something like this. And hopefully, they were able to put it back together as easily as it appears they tore it apart. But they consider the repairability about a 4 out of 10, and 10 would be the easiest to repair. And they say once you manage to take off the bottom cover, all the parts are pretty easily replaceable. But they do say that opening the bottom cover is quite difficult if you don't have the right screwdriver. And they made it very difficult by the type of screws they use. And so that's a good to know. But the RAM and SSD are all proprietary. And the off-the-shelf stuff will probably take a long time to show up in the space. So we'll see what happens, whether or not some of the aftermarket people are able to build anything for this or not. And, of course, on a big note as well, you know, we're at the end of an era for the space shuttle program. The space shuttle Atlantis landed safe and sound at Cape Canaveral this morning. And the International Space Station crew was able to capture a pretty cool image. Let's see if I can actually blow this up. This was on TwitPic. Well, it's about the same. But you can see the reentry burn. They did a nice time lapse on this. So a nice smoke trail going down. What a heck of a ride that must be, you know, doing the reentry. And you just look at the, you know, I think it's pretty remarkable the International Space Station was able to get this good of a shot because, you know, that had to be over a couple of minutes in order to get that. And, you know, the International Space Station's on the move. So I don't know how they did this. And but this is the first time I've ever seen a reentry like that caught. And but it was a nice one to catch. And, of course, that reentry ended with the landing at Kennedy Space Center. And end of an era. Atlantis is going to be on display at the Kennedy Space Center here after they get it decontaminated. So we'll see how many years it's going to be before we go back into space on our own. I know the commercial ventures are going to be rolling up, ramping up. And it'll probably be some time. But isn't that awesome? And many, many years. I think 30 years was the program length. And we lost a lot of good people during those, you know, two accidents. But the orbiter did a great job, and considering as much as they flew it, we're lucky we didn't have any more accidents than we did. Let's talk a little bit about security and TSA. TSA has agreed to take the naked out of naked scanners. And it appears that someone at the TSA just found out that they could be made to work without showing the naked image of a person's body. And they realized it was perhaps a good idea to switch to a version of the software that didn't have to, you know, get all deep and detailed. But it doesn't make me feel any better in standing in front of the stupid thing and getting X-rayed at all. Let me go ahead and bring up see if I can find it. Do I have it easily available? Probably not. Verizon LTE launched here in Hawaii today. And I've got a MiFi, a 4G MiFi with LTE. So I, of course, the first thing you got to do, right, is you got to load the speed test. So I did speed test the first time and was kind of disappointed with the results. I got like 3.2 down and I got like 1.1 up. I said, this is not any faster. And I refreshed the page and actually went to a different speed test and did that one. And it was like 10.9 down and 2.2 megs up. And I thought, oh, that's looking a lot better. And I cleared all my cache and I went back to the other site. And I ran the test again on a different website and about 10.9 again and about 2.1, 2.2 megs up. So pretty impressed. Did a tweak on that with the graphics. You guys can see it. I got 5 bars. It's stroking. It's right where every place I'm using it so far. And I was in 2 or 3 places today with my MiFi. It worked great. And so I'm happy that we've got 4G LTE here. but I know many of you don't, and it's probably going to be a long time coming as well. So we'll see when that makes some progression into other markets. Microsoft announced their quarter four fiscal 11 revenue, earnings, and profits, and they really beat up the expectations. They did $17.37 billion, up 8% over the same period last year, and they had that was for quarter three, of course, and that drove a $5.87 billion in net income, which is a whopping 30% climb over the previous year. So this is big. You know, Microsoft had a good quarter, that's for sure. Now, their online services lost like $800 million. But Xbox and Kinect and all that continues to sell like gangbusters. And you really got to give Microsoft credit on the Xbox and how it's integrated. And it just makes so much sense for folks that have Windows machines to, you know, use the Xbox really in conjunction with your network. So they had a great quarter, and congratulations to Microsoft. We'll see if they can keep it up. And, of course, with a new version of Windows coming in the spring, they should be able to continue to maintain their profits. But I don't know. With a $29 upgrade from Apple, Apple's not worried about making money on the software. That's for sure. They're definitely in the hardware and in, you know, what we're going to buy later. And music and movies and all that stuff. Now, Google did something pretty cool. And I don't know if we talked about this on the last show or not, but when you did if you go to google.com, you need to do any search. Google's doing malware detection now. And people are really applauding what they have done here. And they've been able to do this particular, detect this particular malware because of a redirect. And so much malware tries to keep you away from Google, keep you away from sites that give you advice on how to remove stuff. And I guess we talked about this, but I think if Google even can take and get 25% of the people that are 25% of the machines owners informed, you know, over the million or plus that it had this specific malware installed, that's a huge impact just by putting a little message in their search bar. But I think so many of us also search right from the browser too. I don't go to Google very much. So maybe they can get it to the point where it can report right in the browser. All right, tattoos. One thing when I was growing up, I think when I was just getting ready to go in the Navy, my mom basically said, I don't care what kind of woman you bring home, but don't get a tattoo. And, you know, I've kind of told a lot of my friends that in the past. And I probably, in many years earlier, before I was married, I brought a number of women home and introduced. And, you know, but there's a new tattoo that might just make anyone that has diabetes to consider getting a tattoo. They've got a new, some stuff has basically been designed where they inject just under subsurface of the skin a tattoo, and it's an injection containing carefully chosen nanoparticles into the skin. And the best part, really, this doesn't leave a mark. But what happens is the nanoparticles will turn fluorescent when exposed to a target molecule such as sodium or glucose. And what they're going to be doing is they're going to be using a modified iPhone that would track the changes in level of the fluorescence, which indicates the amount of sodium or glucose present. And what could end up happening here is at some point in the near future, diabetics are going to be able to take their iPhone or device and hold it up to a specific part on their skin and be able to tell what their blood glucose level is and whether or not they need to give themselves a shot of insulin. If they're able to make this happen, millions of people are going to be so happy that they no longer have to poke their finger two or three times a day to check the glucose level of their blood to see whether or not they need to take an insulin shot. So this is awesome, and this is cool technology moving forward. I'm sure We're going to see more and more of this type of stuff as time goes on. But they've got the glucose part down. Now they're going to look at the sodium level too, which is good. Now, would you get that? And would you have that tattoo put in even if you didn't have diabetes? Would you want to check your sodium level? Wouldn't it be kind of cool to basically go doop and get an instant, kind of an instant readout? Or better yet, you've had too much fat for the day and you start getting an indication that you get a little red dot or something, and you say, hey, knock off the cholesterol today, or knock off the cholesterol inducing food. Kind of an interesting thought, isn't it? You know, during this time of year, many of you are not watching the show. Many of you are out doing summer things. So what I'm going to do is, this is kind of unusual because we're right here in the middle of the show, and I'm going to reward those of you that have been over here, have been to this part of the podcast thus far. And what we're going to give away on the next show is we're going to give away one of the new Rokus. And let me show you the new Roku 2. And this is pretty cool. They've come up with some cool stuff. I'm gonna order one for myself as well. But the all-new Roku 2 is available. And they're available starting at $59.99. But here's the kicker on this. The new Roku 2 is going to be able to have some gaming on it. So if you get ready to go buy the new Roku, make sure you buy the $99 one that you can plug a memory stick into. Because what it does is, with it preloaded, it's only got 256 megs of memory inside it. So if you load a bunch of channels, you're really going to be limited in the number of games you can load. But this new version is going to be a gaming console. So anyway, make sure you get the $99 version. It's free shipping. But what I'm going to do here is I'm going to give away one on the show. And if you want one of the new Roku 2s, all you got to do is email me here at geeknews@gmail.com. Just email me, that's all you got to do, and say Roku contest. And that's going to put you right in the running for a Roku, and I'll give one of these away on the Monday show. So to save some time and save some challenges, and I promise I won't share this with anybody else, the disconnect comes in usually with these contests after the show, because I try to get somebody's address. Send me your address in the email. Put your name, your address, your shipping address, so I have it so that I can order it. We don't trade emails back and forth for a week, and it's 2 weeks before you get your device. All right? So, again, I'll give away a $99 Roku. I'm going to order one for me, too. So I'm going to get the XS version, and you'll have the new Roku 2 hockey puck. It looks like they made it about the size of the Apple TV. But pretty exciting stuff here, and you guys know I'm a big Roku fan, largely because we've got all kinds of cool channels over there as well that you guys can watch Geek News Central and all our shows at Tech Podcast and so forth. But you're out during the summer, and Nielsen is basically saying that TV watching, video watching is down. Surprise, surprise. Hey, Doc Searles has a good article, and it's basically, you know, Doc is pretty insightful in most of the stuff he writes about. And back in 2008, he wrote a blog post, A World of Producers. And at the time, he was talking about camcorders, increased bandwidth, demand in both directions. And basically, there's some new stuff out now. There's a new app called Collabracam. And I was really excited to see this. This is pretty awesome stuff. So let me take you to the article that Doc was talking about. So Collabracam works on your iPhone, and it works on your iPad, and basically you and a couple of friends can be out and shooting something, and then you can edit the event and put together multiple shots from the folks that were working together to do the movie. And this is cool. This is really cool. So two or three people, and I can see how we're going to use this. My team members that all have iPhones, when we go to events, Tech Podcast goes to events, we're going to be using Collabracam. We really are. Because we're going to use this, and it's going to be fun, and we're going to really stoke it up a little bit by having some of those nice device that you can plug the iPhone into and then have a nice camera on it. It'll be a lot of fun. But Collabracam, Collabracam, you'll find it in the App Store. Don't know what it costs. Doesn't matter. It's probably one of the coolest apps I've seen in a long time, and multiple people shooting, and then it just makes it easier to tie together. If you've been having problems as well with moving on to the next topic, Facebook apparently has got some pushback on their recent iPhone update that happened a couple of weeks ago, and they've been getting thousands of negative reviews. And there's some speculation by the folks over at Financial Times that there may be a reason for the app revolt and the lack of response from Facebook. They seem to think that because Facebook has never done any aggressive innovation around the app, and since its release in 2008, having it lag behind feature sets, and with the creator of the Facebook iPhone app having left the company in May, they feel that Facebook may be working on an HTML5 solution where, and I really, honestly, I love an HTML5 solution because all you got to do is remember the URL and you put it in the browser and you just go to Facebook.com, and when it comes up, you don't have the regular Facebook page. You have basically what looks like the app on a web page. And I've been really a big fan of that for a long time, specifically because you're not beholden to the Apple infrastructure. And so it appears that they may be working on an HTML5 version. So we'll see. We'll see if this happens. Hey, also, as well, I forgot to announce this. Raw Voice has basically been talking with Apple for a while. And we are now, the Tech Podcast Network, ProMed Network, and Travelcast have their own producer pages. So basically now, when you're looking for shows in the Tech Podcast Network, you can go over to our producer page and find all of the different network shows right in iTunes. They're all right there aggregated together. We've got nice graphic arts in there. If you want to just, and if you're looking for a specific tech podcast show, when you're in iTunes and you click the podcast link, all you got to type in the search bar is Tech Podcast, and we'll be in the special link on the right-hand column of iTunes, and you'll be able to click that and get right in and see some of the popular shows recently updated, and we encourage you all to go over and check that out. Check out our ProMed listing as well, along with Travelcast, and we're real happy to have made this jump with Apple. We could have done it a long time ago, but basically I finally found the right person at Apple to talk to make it happen, and I can't go into the full details of how it all works, but if you guys look at my Geek News Central video listing, you will see something new in that listing, and be very different than a normal iTunes show listing. And I'm really excited about being able to up the game within the iTunes marketplace for this show, at least, or for our shows at Tech Podcast, ProMed, and Travelcast. I don't know why I didn't talk about that earlier. I was too worried about getting through the other stuff. So let's talk just a little bit about some other cool stuff here. Have you heard about Rovio being sued by Lodesys? You know, Lodesys started suing app developers in late May. And basically, Lodesys is going after Rovio now over Angry Birds for the iPhone and Android. And this brings the total number of people that Lodesys is suing to 37. And they are not seeming to back down. It doesn't appear that Apple is trying to help. I don't know how this is going to end up, but Lodesys is going after the apps that are making a lot of money and looking for royalties and looking to license their patents. So it'll be interesting how this all works out in the end, and I don't know if this is going to be end up being Achilles' heel for the app stores or not. So that's why HTML5 is always good. It's also being said that Apple is considering making a bid for Hulu. You know, they got $76.2 billion in cash, so they got to do something with that money, and it's burning a hole in their pocket. So it's determined, rumored, that they're in talks to acquire Hulu, and of course that would fit very nicely into their Apple TV and into the rest of their ecosphere. the folks over at Google Plus have been getting a lot of heat. A lot of heat from businesses about why they are not, why they're allowing like Mashable and Ford to be in the in Google Plus, but they're killing other company listings. And so basically they did a Google for Business update 3, which still does not seem to appease the masses. Everyone's still complaining, but latest I heard was that the Mashable listing was removed. I don't know if the Ford one was removed. Let's see if I can find Mashable. Let me look here. Mashable is, oh, someone's doing Mashable news. So there's not a, yeah, they kept, what did they do? Oh, wow. Well, they basically changed the, Mashable took their logo head off the top of the page. And the only thing that they, he did was he put his picture in there, and they transferred the 106,000 people that are following him into that. So that's what they've apparently have done instead of having their actual Mashable listing up. But there was quite the discussion in the echo chamber today about basically Google playing unfair with businesses. So, but Google is basically, like I said, they're going to hurry up. And I say they're going to be ready in a couple of months. Well, a couple of months is an eternity in the online space. So they need to rock and roll and get this thing knocked out for businesses. We'll see how long it takes them. If you have upgraded to Lion, there is going to be a build of Google Chrome coming for OS X Lion. But it's going to take some time. They're going to make some changes. And how many of you that upgraded to Lion like the new, what they've changed on the scroll? Leave it to Steve Jobs to tell us we've all been scrolling the wrong way. Let's talk about, let's see here. Let's skip him because I've got this later. Let's drag it down there. Another article. Nokia. Whoo. Oh my goodness. $657 million in losses for this last quarter. Wow. They are in big trouble. Their phones are not helping. They don't have a good smartphone response yet. Android's squeezing them. Obviously, the iPhone is just crushing them. And so how long can this go on? You know, more people use a Nokia phone than drink a Coca-Cola is what they say. So how can this be possible? Is Nokia going to survive? I know Nokia is still big outside of the United States, but these types of losses, that's huge money. I don't know how much cash they have on reserve, but their stock is going to get hammered. And they have got to hurry up and make a move. $692 million quarterly loss. So they don't even talk about revenue in any of these articles. They just talk about the loss. So, you know, with Apple selling 20.34 million iPhone sales for the past quarter, which is 142% boost over last year, and with Samsung having expected to have sold 20 million smartphones the same period, the Nokia's smartphones declined 34% with only 16.7 million smartphones sold. So, wow. Now they're making the transition to Microsoft, so we'll see what happens with that. But I don't know if they can they be saved? Are they going to stay in business? Over on Earth2Tech, which is a blog over at GigaOM. Like a lot of GigaOM articles tonight. They've got an article talking about how cloud computing is going to lead to billions in energy savings. And that didn't want to load. Must be that. I wonder why. Sending a request. Waiting, waiting, waiting. So here's the question. Do you think cloud computing is really going to save money? And do you think that because businesses are going to upload stuff to the cloud that they're going to be able to shut down gear I don't know. I think we're going to be sending a lot of data to the cloud. I don't think we're going to be shutting down our computers. And if anything, some of them are going to be running longer. So, but they think that cloud computing could lead to billions in energy savings. Hey, I'm looking over here in chat. And How's It Joe says, and he's talking about his Apple machines. He says, yeah, I got it on two machines so far. I wish I had done the DMG copy to USB stick before installing on the second machine. He says, if you go to your dashboard and click on the plus button on the bottom left, it looks just like an iPhone with the widget programs on the bottom. So I guess I don't understand about the, if you go to your dashboard and click on the plus button on the bottom left, it looks like an iPhone with a widget. I have no idea what you're talking. If you're still listening, How's It Joe? Tell me what you mean about the dashboard. Maybe I'm thinking about the wrong thing here. But anyway, we'll see what happens with this cloud computing if it comes to fruition. Let's talk a little bit about AT&T. AT&T had a solid second quarter, and it was largely driven by wireless, but its wireline business was nearing growth again. And but here's the disturbing part. On Thursday morning, an analyst, and this was on the earnings call, an analyst asked what happened to the AT&T service areas that don't get upgraded to UVerse. And this UVerse is tied to their ADSL and, or the DSL lines. And whether the business in those areas was falling off or stable. The senior executive vice president CFO replied, we're seeing some challenges in these markets and the long-term response will be what, and he handed this over to AT&T's general counsel who was on the call and basically said that what they're going to do is instead of really improving service into areas that don't have service right now, as AT&T builds out LTE with their T-Mobile acquisition, that they're going to cover areas that currently don't have internet access with LTE. Now, they said that was their long-term answer. Now, we know that Verizon is selling off its DSL lines to other service providers. And so is that what's going to happen now? Is that AT&T, Verizon, and these companies that basically own a lot of copper are basically going to throw away a huge part of the market and are not going to go out and make available a cable offering or a DSL offering to customers in areas that are, you know, in hard-to-service areas. They're going to push them on LTE. Well, LTE does not have an unlimited bandwidth pipe. You know, they said, oh, yeah, you can say, if I could get my mom on an LTE that has the same speeds as we have here, and she had an unlimited pipe, she'd have a great connection. But she likes to watch me and other stuff on Netflix and then on, you know, a variety of different channels on the Roku. So for her, you know, she needs to be hardwired. And I don't think that LTE is going to solve people that don't have access issues. Free music is always good. And I'm always looking forward. I love when South by Southwest comes around because they always have a huge archive of free music that the artists have released. Some of it, you know, gets immediately put in the trash can. Some of it's great. But with there's an artist out there with more than 300,000 tracks, a series of artists, and 50,000 albums has been published to a service called Jamendo, J-A-M-E-N-D-O. I guess it's Jamendo. And Jamendo is a site that originally started out having mostly French artists on board. But Jamendo today features 38,000 artists from all around the world who together have published 315,000 tracks across 50,000 albums spanning a wide range of genres, and they're all free. It's served by peer-to-peer, and it's royalty-free. You can download it and listen to your heart's content. But this is, I've never knew about this service whatsoever. And I was going to bring it up and see if we can actually take a peek at the front page of the website. Let's see if it loads here for me. Are they getting crushed? It says sending requests. We'll see if it actually loads. If it loads, I'll come back to it and we'll talk about it. Yeah, it doesn't want to load. Is my network still up? Am I still online, guys? I guess we'll find out here in a second. Yeah, it looks like. Am I still live? Or did we die? Gosh. Oh, man. It never fails. Something always goes wrong, doesn't it? Let me double check here. It looks like, you know, what's been happening is I think complaining to my cable provider is resulting in some issues, but we'll get through the rest of the content. Yeah, stream is down. That sucks. That just royally sucks big time. Okay. Interactive's been charged in MIT data theft. And this is big. The activist was basically charged for downloading huge, huge amounts of what's called the JSTOR, and it's an archive of scientific journals and academic papers. And it was done by a guy by the name of Aaron Schwartz. He's a 24-year-old programmer, and he's been basically charged with downloading all this stuff. And he was basically doing all types of stuff, at least in the indictment, doing all kinds of things to avoid detection of what he was doing. And the indictment reads pretty damning. It really, really does. So we'll see what happens with him. But he's been arrested and already out on bail. But he was one of the co-founders of Reddit. And this doesn't bode well for him over the long haul. That's for sure. So let me do something here real quick, folks. Let me bounce this and let me try to make a quick change on something while we're live and try to make a reset. Oh, that wasn't good. Reset on the network here. Hang on. All right, we'll see if that does it. That just totally blows. So anyway, he's in jail. Now, what has happened is some sympathizers of him have started to upload documents that they've got from the same repository. And a gentleman by the name of Greg Maxwell uploaded a torrent with 18,592 scientific publications to the Pirate Bay. And it's a 32 gigabit torrent, and it was taken from the JSTOR academic database a while ago. But here's the thing: these individual articles can cost as much as $19. And what's really kind of BS about this is that these documents are all submitted by individuals that don't get any type of compensation. And they sometimes done peer reviews and that type of stuff, but they're all basically up there. And so MIT charges people to access them. And so, you know, he feels the stuff should be free because it's, you know, no one's getting compensated for the submission of stuff. So we'll see where this goes over time. But anyway, the docs are up, at least this initial set of docs were up on... I've been set up on the Pirate Bay. So, well, okay, I know you're complaining, so don't... My computer's all complaining they can't reach the network right now. This happened last week, and we're going to have to investigate this in a big way. You know, and I don't know if it's because I'm pushing... I'm on a commercial line, so I don't know why I'm losing service. We're going to have to make a trouble call, I guess, to the... Yeah, I reset my network and it came back up. Now they must be. We're gonna have to have a discussion with the provider. Well, let's talk. Let's move on here and talk about Firefox 8. Firefox for 8 for Windows is going to have a 64-bit version. It's only available as a beta right now. But if you want to download the nightly install of Firefox 8, you can do so. and get a 64-bit of this. Got a good review on it and the performance of it, and so far everyone's pretty happy with the performance of the Firefox 8. So in this specific model, so definitely if you get a chance, go over there and check it out. I have a link up to this, of course, in the show notes, like I always do. Let's the folks over at Ogizmo have a pretty cool key, and you know, you think a key. You found a cool key. How can you find a cool key? Well, let me show you this. It's a key that's got a carbineer. I guess that's how you pronounce it. And basically, it's just like if you could snap it onto your key ring. And, you know, I hate having to, you know, adjust keys on a key ring and get my fingers pinched and all this stuff. But it's called Keybird. Sells for $9. And carabiner model is what they really are. A carabiner, that's the correct pronunciation. But way cool. That is a cool gadget. YouTube has launched paid live streaming with Willow.tv. So if you're a cricket fan, so you'll soon be able to get the India tour of England live on YouTube. It's going to cost you $99 for a six-month season pass. So if you're a cricket fan, Willow TV is going to be the place to go. Hey, have any of you been one of the 19% that have dropped your mobile device in a toilet? It appears a study is reporting that 19% of us have dropped our phones into the toilet. That just sounds so disgusting. No, I have not dropped my phone in the toilet. Came close, but have not done so. Hey, Google Toolbar for Firefox has been discontinued. So this is the end of an era. So really, if you've updated to the newest Firefox, you're going to find that toolbar no longer works and is no longer available from the folks at Google. Those of you that are been using Google Docs and also use Microsoft Office, there's a plugin now where you can do, it's called Google Cloud Connect. And it's basically a plugin for Word where you can share your documents that you have, you're working on your desktop. You can push them up to the cloud. It's pretty sexy. I really like it. And you'll be able to sync stuff up. And you can choose which documents you're going to send and which ones you're not. And you can make a copy on Google. Awesome stuff. And I was playing with it a little bit this afternoon. It works fabulous. It really, really does. Over on Lifehacker, this is probably the article of the night that I want you guys to pay attention to. And I'm going to end here on this article tonight. It's an article about how this gentleman cut his energy bill by a third with tech and common sense. If you're worried about your energy bill going up, you need to read this article tonight that I'm going to have for you. This is it's going to save your life. It's going to it's going to save you a lot of money, and he's got a lot of great features in here, some commercial solutions. And basically, it's amazing how much he was able to lower his electricity bill with some common sense and using a little tech as well. One of the best articles I've read in a long time, and believe it or not, one of the solutions cost about $700. And if I could save $50 a month on my electricity bill, this thing would pay for itself here, you know, in a year. So I'm going to heavily look at the commercial solution that they have to see what I can do to save some money. All right, I've got some voicemail comments tonight, and we'll get into those here right now. And I've got, let's do the email first, because I ran out of time on the last show. We'll do the email first, and then we'll get into the voicemail. I got an email from Robert. He said, on Thursday's show, you mentioned browser ID. Rather than forcing users to use a specific identity service, I'd rather see a site let users choose which identity service they prefer to use. For example, OpenID allows using a number of different sites, but requires authenticating each website separately. To avoid that hassle, there's the GitKit Federated Login System that allows users to choose whether to log in with their Gmail, AOL, Hotmail, or Yahoo address and password, or any other email address. So he's got some links here for me. And but anyway, good stuff. Thanks, Rob, for that. I do appreciate it. Got an email here from Jack, and he says, hey, Todd, this is so cool. It's a parahawking over Nepal. It's a video. I have that link up for you in the show notes you can check out. Got an email here from Miss Small Biz. She says, I've been trying to get a bit more attention on, and this is the subject about, can the feds make you give up your password? She said, I've been trying to get a bit more attention on this subject because it has far-reaching effects. If you use a fingerprint scanner to encrypt, could they force you to use your finger to open it? Could they take your finger since they can take your blood? Okay, that's an extreme. She says, in this review, Declan McClaw says that the courts can't make you provide the combination of safe, but can make you give them a key, according to the courts. So does this mean using something like a YubiKey is a bad idea going forward versus a strong password? Are they admitting that BitLocker and Apple File Vaults don't have backdoors for the feds, which many of us think they do? Or is it more likely that the backdoors are there, but they don't want to have to show in court that they can get in without passwords? This is an article that she linked to over on NPR. Got an email here from Jeffrey Powers over at Geekazine. Oh, Jeffrey Ramsey. He says, I'm still learning Google Plus. I'm updating Todd and respect him. I've been listening to Todd for a long time, purchased many URLs using his GoDaddy codes. I realize I'm not targeting a big audience, but would appreciate any support. I'm fighting SCI complications and use social media new technology. It says I've got a new Dell XPS, and maybe I'll find some new technology to share. I have in the past. Try the info at jrwounds.com. And this is, of course, Jeffrey Ramsey, one of our long listeners, and he's at Jeffrey L. Ramsey on Twitter. Thanks, Jeffrey, for sending me that over on Google+. I got an email here from Tyler. Say, hey, Todd, I've been listening to your podcast since I first got my iPod in 2004. Please send me a Google invite. Tyler, you should have got one. So if anybody else wants one, geekazine@gmail.com. Got an email from Bruce. He says, hey, Todd, quick question to your bandwidth charges. I use Virgin Media in the UK, cable-based, 50 megs down, 5 megs up for $100 a month, no cap, upgrading to 100 megs down before Olympics next year for same price. Virgin Media is the fastest in the UK, and that is based on cable network. Regards, Bruce in the UK. Hey, thanks for the email, and thanks for rubbing it in, Bruce. Got an email here from Susabel. She says, regarding the article about painting roof white, this is not a silly idea, but a great one. The urban heat island effect is part of what is heating up our country today. As much of the U.S. continues to swelter in an intense heat wave where temps barely drop below 90 degrees even overnight, white roofs could be making all the difference. A 20% reduction in cooling bills for buildings with white roof tells a tale of how this really works. White reflects light and heat, while dark roofs absorb heat. Even a brown or gray roof absorbs more heat than a white roof. All roofing shingles should be light in color, and roofs that are flat and covered in tar paper should be painted white. When I chose shingles for my house a few years ago, I specifically chose a light color. The urban heat island effect, where temperatures are higher in urban areas for longer periods of time than non-urban areas, occurs when the heat builds up but has nowhere to go even when the sun is down. Brick buildings, asphalt roads, lack of green space, and yes, dark-colored roofing all contribute to this effect. In Chicago last night at 3:30 in the morning, it was still 90 degrees. I'm all for white roofs on buildings. It's an idea that should have been embraced years ago, Susabel. Thanks, Susabel, for your email on that. And let's go ahead and bounce right into the voicemail, and I think we'll have enough time to get the show wrapped.
This is Alan Bunt calling from the lovely warm state here in Wisconsin, central U.S., and it's the 18th of July here, about close to 4 o'clock here, central daylight time. I just wanted to give you a call real quick. I've been watching you for quite a long time, and watching your video streams basically through iTunes after the fact, because I never can catch them during live for some reason. Everybody does their live shows on Thursday, and that's when I do my live show. So. Uh-huh. Whatever you've done recently, hats off to you. I'm watching the current Geek News Central 688 right now. Full HD, full screen, looks lovely. And the file size did not go up very much, so that's very good. Looks like the file size for your show here, an hour and 6 minutes, about a gig and a half. That's not bad for full HD. That's very, very good. The quality on it on my 24-inch monitor here is outstanding. Before it used to be a little shadowy and such, a little fuzzy if I watched it full screen, but the HD version is full screen. So whatever you've done, hats off to you. It's the right way. My question is I was wondering if you're going to offer a standard definition version also on iTunes that for my one of my slower computers. I was wondering if you're going to offer that at all.
Yep.
Or not. I am a member of, I am a Blueberry podcast member, and it's www.onegoodshepherd.org. We podcast weekly, and we do broadcast live also, using a different piece of software, VidBlaster.
Yeah.
And I believe you're a user of that also when you're mobile. Just want to say hi out there to all the Ohana out there and everybody watching. Hats off, Todd. Doing a good job. I don't watch too many of the other podcasts, but now that the quality is up to HD, maybe I will start. So, and if you have any questions, you can contact me at wiav8r@gmail.com. That's how you get a hold of me. And, again, great show. Good job. Talk to you later.
Hey, thanks. Bye-bye. Thanks for calling. And his website was onegoodshepherd.com. I tried to bring it up on I must have typed it in wrong, but definitely check his show out. Of course, it's on blueberry.com as well. But yeah, we're using a Blackmagic H.264 encoder. It's made all the difference in the world. Now, if you look in the show notes, you'll find an RSS feed for the show. Now, there is a trick to get that into iTunes. We haven't submitted it to iTunes for the 640x360 version, which is the SD version of the show. Trying to keep the number of listings down. I'll probably end up having to do that at some point here, but you can use that in iTunes with just a straight RSS feed. But I think there's going to be enough people asking for it that we'll go ahead and submit that to iTunes and get the RSS feed in. But I'm glad the HD is working for you. I'm totally stoked about the quality, and yeah, I'm watching the file size, believe me, because it gets expensive to deliver. There was a couple of more voicemails on here. I don't know if these are real deals. Let me see who this is.
Hello. This is a courtesy text-to-phone message. You have an important voicemail waiting.
Oh, I do.
Call 800-296.
Oh, well, we'll close that. Voice-to-text message. Maybe someone... I probably need to check that out, because we have listeners of the show that are... hearing impaired or vision impaired that do call sometimes that way, but, or maybe even, I don't know. We'll have to see. All right, let me go ahead and got one more here.
More info.
Oh, that was a spam voicemail. All right, we're done. We're late. Everyone, thanks for hanging out. Again, if you've got comments about the show, geeknews@gmail.com. Voicemail hotline 619-342-7365. And of course, don't forget our sponsors over at GoDaddy. Think about picking up a trial of GoToMeeting or even your free trial of Carbonite. Thanks, everybody, for hanging out with me here. It's been my pleasure to bring you this edition of the Geekness Central podcast. Those of you that were on the stream, sorry about that. We'll figure what's going on with the network here tonight or tomorrow when I call the provider and have a streaming match. We'll see you next time. Everyone take care and aloha.